Please take your seat so we can begin this evening's meeting.
So we can't.
Good evening. We're going to have the invocation this evening from Chaplain Stanley Owen, from the Clayton County Sheriff's Department, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand.
Let us pray. Lord, we're grateful tonight for the freedoms that we have. We're grateful tonight for the many blessings that you have given to us out of your goodness. And we come to you tonight asking that you would continue to guide this great county, those who are elected, the decisions that will be made, and throughout this county. Let your blessings be upon us. And we thank you for it tonight. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to remind you at this time that this business meeting is being televised. If you have any concern or comment to make before the Board of Commissioners tonight, and you come up to this portable podium, please speak directly in the microphone so that we can hear you clearly. Thank you. And next, I will announce for you the revisions to the agenda tonight that the Board of Commissioners generally consented to having. If you look at page 5, item number 16, that is ordinance 2014-118. The first reading is being deleted for further review and modification. Also, we're deleting on page 2, subsection 8, a request presented by Carol Rogers of Central Services. And that would be RFP package 13-31, Splash Construction Management Risk Services for the construction of Clayton County Police Precinct Northeast Contract GMP Amendment. And I understand that Central Services is checking and verifying equipment pricing and the plan review for that particular item. On page 5, under item number 15, which is Renee Bright, Director of Human Resources, we have some good news to report tonight. That's subsection 1 for the renewal of the self-funded medical plan stop-loss coverage for plan year June of this year to May of next year. There will be no increase in premium. You'll see that in the last sentence where it says there is going to be a 2.26% increase in premium. There will be no increase in premium. And lastly, I'd like to announce that the executive session being held tonight pertains to litigation and personnel matters. With that being said, may we have a motion to adopt the agenda with those revisions, please.
I move that we adopt the agenda with the noted changes.
Second.
Probably moved and second. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous.
Okay, and next we have approval of the May 6, 2014 regular business meeting minutes.
I move that we approve the minutes.
I'll second it. Probably moved and second. Those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous.
Okay. This time the board will hear from the public. Citizens will be given a 3-minute maximum time limit to speak before the Board of Commissioners. Following 30 minutes of hearing from the public, the Board of Commissioners will allow the remainder of citizens who have signed up to be heard at the next business meeting. And in light of that being said, it looks like we have 24 people who have signed up. If any of you inadvertently signed your name on this public comment and you really wanted to make comments under zoning, we'll ask that you wait until the zoning petitions are actually heard. Let me ask Patricia Hammett, is your request concerning a zoning petition on tonight's agenda? Yes, you have signed up under public comment, which is a separate category. Are you here for a zoning petition tonight? So you're here for the zoning petition. Okay, so we'll hear you. I'm trying to explain that we'll be hearing you later when the zoning petitions are actually presented before the board, as opposed to now under public comment. So I'll put a star by her name, Chairman, so you'll know that.
Okay.
Okay, and then there's a Joan Perry. She has Mount Zion. Oh, is it Jean? I'm sorry, it looks like Joan. Okay, Jean. And are you here for a zoning petition? Okay, I'll put a star by your name as well. Okay, all right. All right, those two were the most obvious, but anybody else who signed up, did you sign up for a zoning petition as well? Okay, and what's your name? Terrell. Is that the first or last name? Nancy Terrell, okay. Nancy Terrell. Okay, DeQuita Terrell, is that it? Okay, I'll put a star by your name. Okay, so we have three individuals who have actually signed up to be heard under the zoning section.
One more.
What's your name? Okay, speak up, please. I can barely. Okay, let's see if I see that.
It's number 13, I think.
Yes, okay. Okay, anybody else for zoning petition?
Is it too late to sign up?
That's up to the board. Now, please realize that under zoning petitions, if you have pretty much the same concerns and you have a lot of people here, you may want to designate a spokesperson to speak on your behalf so we won't end up being repetitive about, you know, our concerns for particular zoning or rezoning. Just keep that in mind, but that's up to the board about signing up. We have over the allotted amount anyway, Chairman, because we said up to 30 minutes, so.
Mr. Turner, is your request for the zoning petition or the public comment?
Zoning petition.
Okay.
CUP.
Right. Madam Clerk, you said we already have over the amount, or?
Yes, because actually 24 people signed up, and with the four stars, that's 20 people. And three times two is 60 minutes. Mm-hmm. And we say we're allotting up to.
Sorry, Ms. Turner. No.
30 minutes of hearing. We may have to cut off, you know, after the 30 minutes as we have on the agenda. But I'll go ahead and pass this up to you, Chairman. And remember that where you see the stars, that means that these individuals actually want to speak under the zoning segment of the agenda. Mm-hmm.
Okay, Mr. Jasmine Patton. Ms. Jasmine Patton.
Good afternoon. I have a really general comment. It was based on the transit meeting that I attended yesterday at Point South Middle School. The main comment that I wanted to make was concerning you all's lack of integrating social media to be able to reach out to young adults. If it wasn't for my parent who lives off of that area, I probably wouldn't have known of that meeting. And I currently take the Greta Express to and from work because I find it a lot more convenient as well as a lot less of a hassle. So I'm in support of the Transit Committee coming into Clayton County, but a lot of people that I know as college peers had no idea that you all were kind of announcing this meeting. Even today, as I looked on the Clayton County and Riverdale, City of Riverdale Town Hall Twitter pages, there was really no announcement of the election or really no campaign to kind of get the vote out there or to want people to encourage them. And when I went to vote around 2 o'clock today, there was only like 86 people. And it kind of dawned on me that maybe if the transit system was in the county, you would have more active voters as well as more of an active young adult participation in the county as a whole. Coming back from college, you want to be able to kind of come back to your roots and be able to start a life here, but there's very little appeal because it seems like a lot of focus is placed on elder or middle-aged people who already have their lives settled. But I think that a lot of times people overlook the growth potential as well as earning income of people my age that are fresh out of college and have really good jobs and want to be able to spend money in their own communities, but you kind of force this out to look to places in North Atlanta because of the fact that there are very little shopping, very little commerce opportunities, and very little transportation alternatives. And so that was mainly my comment.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Ann McCollum.
She did that well. I'm one of the old duffers. I'm a homeowner from Clayton County since 1984, and I taught at Riverdale High School for 17 years. And before I get to my point, I just want to say something in general. I'm well aware of Clayton County's loss of tax base over the many years being a homeowner and seeing property values decline and so on. And I want to let the board know how much I appreciate the services that we get in Clayton County for the amount of money that we pay. And I think you guys are really good leaders, and you have got great employees to get all the stuff we do, given the fact that our tax base, I mean, the amount our houses are worth has declined so much. So I really want to congratulate you for that. I'm just going to reiterate, anytime I've dealt with the police, they've been wonderful. Animal control has served us well. Our little recycling plant, great. And Parks and Recreation is fantastic. And I'm especially putting in a plug for Reynolds Nature Preserve. Okay, I've been to two of the meetings about the transit, and that's probably what I'm here for. Anybody that I talk to is like, yeah, we really need this. It's got to happen. Last night, after being at the second meeting at Riverdale, something did occur to me that I want to bring up here, a little quibble. And that is that we were given this proposal, and it's been very professionally done. Things look amazing when presented and everything. But I don't think it was clearly presented what we would get for the half penny and what we would get for the penny. And I think what we were seeing there was probably what we would get for a whole penny's worth of sales tax. And it was wonderful. I mean, amazing. It even came by our house, and I'm like, oh my gosh. So I really think that that's something that would help if it was clear that we could see that. And also, they asked us for public input, and we got to say where we lived, where we wanted to go to, and then they put all that data crunch together and stuff. But it didn't seem to me like they were asking for a lot of public input on just which system we wanted. Did we want the full MARTA system, or did we want half a system? And the people that I talk to say, yeah, we want a good system. We want this to be the MARTA system. Give us the whole works. And so I'm just putting my two cents in for the full package. And I think that is all. I think we will be in a better place in Clayton County because of a much better transportation system. And I thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Alicia, looks like Corret. Alicia Corret. Is that Garrett? Garrett, Alicia Garrett.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no problem. Thank you. For the record, it's Garrett, right?
It's Garrett. Okay.
Thank you. Sorry. Antoine Danford.
I signed up in there as well.
Okay. Dr. Wilbert Jordan.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
Okay. I want to thank the commissioners for conducting the transportation feasibility studies. One of the concerns that I had is that those who needed it the most could not get to the meeting. The meeting was about the need for transportation, and they could not get to the meeting. For the most part, those who attended selected routes that would not address the needs of the workers who needed transportation. For example, Gate Gourmet, a major service supplier for Delta and most of the other airlines, employed 1,000 people. A large percentage of those employees live in Clayton County. When C-Tran, which used to stop in front of their facility, ceased to operate, many of their employees who lived in Clayton County could no longer get to their job at Gate Gourmet. My son, who's been there for 8 years, who gets seizures, so I have to drive him there, used to use C-Tran. Now every morning I have to take him there to work and bring him back. There are other airport employees who lost employment who live in Clayton County as well. The employees did not have reliable transportation, so they couldn't keep those jobs. Those jobs demand reliable transportation. Gate Gourmet pays its employees more than the minimum wage and offer good benefits. Now, these people had to either settle for lesser paid jobs closer to home or leave the county, and a lot of them did leave Clayton County and left us with a lot of vacancies. The transportation study should be geared more to those that transportation would have a greater impact on their lives. It seems that a large number of people who attended the meetings were more concerned about their property tax being increased than they were about those who depended on public transportation to earn a living. They completely disregarded the fact that this was about a sales tax, not a property tax. A community that will not consider the needs of the least is not a community that will grow and prosper.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. John Duke. Mr. Duke. Okay, could have quiet, please.
Hello, commissioners. Thank you for letting me speak. I live in College Park. I've lived there for 15 years, and part of our city does fall into Clayton County. I live on the Fulton County side. I come into Clayton County, if not weekly, daily, to visit friends. I visit clients. I give people tours of the Clayton County Water Authority at the public areas. It's an amazing water authority you have here. I do Audubon bird counts here in the county. I'm not a resident, but this is a regional issue, the transit debate you're having, and I've been going to all the feasibility studies. And I've given you an analysis of what the comparable infrastructure would cost to Clayton County if you were to try to mimic the same services that MARTA currently provides in Fulton and DeKalb counties. And there were several times last night at the Riverdale meeting that I was at, there was question about speeding up the 2040 plan. When would bus rails be replaced by rail? There was also a discussion about how much of a burden is a 1% sales tax going to give to the county, and it was determined that a large ticket item like car sales would be exempt. So I do see the side of why not going to a whole 8%. I do see that, but in order to have a very good transit, regional transit system that I think the people in this county really want, it is not cheap. And that should be made clear, as the lady said before, on the options on what the county would be getting on how much you're putting in. I just want to point out on the spreadsheet there that the if Clayton County had joined MARTA in 1972, it would only contribute 13% to MARTA total revenues, yet it would already have rail service to the number one and number two destination places that the transit feasibility study has uncovered, and that is to downtown Atlanta and the airport. The other thing I want to point out on the other second sheet I gave you is the South Fulton unconstrained transportation list that they spent $500,000 to do. The two items I've given you there from that list is rail extension from East Point to the Fulton County line, and it includes the Southern Crescent Multimodal Station inside Clayton County. That's $350 million worth of transit infrastructure that Clayton County would not have to pay for. So it's a collaboration, I think, that works well. So I'll just ask you, maybe just listen to your constituents, see how much they would want to put into the system. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Kathy Sheely.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It's Schley.
What?
Schley. It's harder to pronounce. I am a mental health counselor, and I actually work at the jail. And I'm going off topic to something completely different. I am actually here to advocate for your support for the mental health court. As you know, the court started last June. They obtained a grant, and we're hoping that the county commission will be willing to fund just one position so that we can continue to keep that program going. So far, the program's had 10 participants, and overall, it's been very successful. And as you know, I'm sure, having that mental health court will help to reduce recidivism among this population. It also helps to save the county money because we're not keeping those individuals incarcerated. They receive the benefit of treatment instead of incarceration, and their treatment plans and their goals are surrounded by treatment rather than things like probation. It's all in an effort to try to help these individuals become more productive in the community, to enhance their wellness, and to obtain a better quality of life. So I really hope that the county commission will look seriously at funding just this one position so that we can keep this mental health court going.
Thank you.
Kimberly Kirby.
Good evening. I'm Kimberly Kirby, a homeowner in Clayton County. I want to start by thanking Chairman Turner and Commissioner Hambrick for accepting my invitation and coming down to Animal Control to show the voters that you do care. Kudos to you. The mandatory personal escort for all who enter the kennel area is extremely impeding to our rescue efforts and puts a strain on the animal control and the rescue relations. We're waiting up to 15 plus minutes for an escort. A color-coded line system on the floor or a map would be efficient and more cost-effective than disrupting the animal control officers who are trying to work. Even Captain Thompson, on a captain's salary at that, has to take time out to escort. If this escort service is in place to make sure visitors see all the animals when looking to reclaim a pet, it is still at fault due to the fact that many animals are on the inaccessible bite side due to lack of large kennels. All of the yellow kennels on this chart is off limits. What if my dog is there? I'm concerned with the fact that Lake City pays the city of Forest Park to pick up animals. Forest Park in turn brings the animals to us without paying. This is stressful on our animal control. If we truly want to be a no-kill county, we need the contract between Forest Park and Clayton County to be renewed, or we need to take over, therefore eliminating Forest Park Animal Control. This is only fair to the taxpayers of Clayton County. I'm concerned with the fact that Animal Control continues to patrol the streets on evenings and weekends. Not only is this unsafe to the officers, but the intake of animals during off hours is quite expensive. If we want to spend this money, it should be to have evening hours and longer weekend hours so as to increase adoptions and reclaims for the working public, therefore decreasing the strain of us having an insufficient amount of large kennels. I would like to introduce you to the Companion Animal Protection Act. It is a bill being passed in many places that seeks to legislate shelters following the no-kill equation and has proven to be quite successful. I've attached for you a basic template which will put true no-kill within our reach. I applaud the county for adopting most of the CAPA's ways, but more must be done. If the county would invite Lifeline Animal Project in, I do believe all of the CAPA's requirements would be well within reach. We need all animals altered and vetted before leaving animal control. We need a 5-day hold on all animals, even owner surrenders. Exceptions need to be made for evening, weekend, and holiday intakes. If a dog is brought in on a Saturday night, it can be killed on Tuesday morning. That is only half a work day with a picture up and being networked. Don't they deserve a chance to be saved? We need proper treatment of injuries and diseases. We need 48 hours advance notice prior to euthanizing an animal. We do not need to kill healthy animals if there are empty kennels. We need public accountability posted in a conspicuous and observable spot so that everyone entering our doors knows that we kill healthy animals, perhaps swaying them not to surrender. We need proper storage of food supplies, which would eliminate many potential diseases from all of the rat and roach infestation at Clayton County Animal Control. These are areas that need to be addressed. And last, we need for Partners for Pets to be included in the design of the new building. Partners has much to offer, being that on a daily basis, partners are hands-on. How can we let people who have never been to animal control mandate what they do not know? I, as a taxpayer, would like to know where we are on the new building. And on the lighter side, just for your information, a Clayton County dog is up for a part in a big Broadway play of Mice and Men. Morgan Freeman's chauffeur has adopted from us. Morgan Fairchild sponsors Clayton. And we also have a Clayton dog in Paris, France.
Excuse me, Ms. Kirby. I'm sorry. Your time is up.
Thank you.
Thank you. Kirby.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman and county commissioners, I am a homeowner and resident of this county and have been all my life. My parents grew up in Clayton County, and they sharecropped cotton and corn and whatever they had to do through the Great Depression, but they never killed their domestic animals. And Clayton County does. And if they were alive and here by me today, they would be standing with me, along with thousands of concerned citizens. We beg you and we ask you to stop euthanizing the animals. There are means that you can take where we can place them in rescues. The plans you have to build another facility to wipe out the one that's there with the same amount of cells isn't going to cure the problem. You know, let's work together and find a way to stop killing God's little angels. Me and my wife work together. We spend our money and our time to save as many animals as we can. And the little creatures we got running around the house now, you look in their eyes, there's no way in the world that you would want to kill them just because you don't have facilities to hold them. So please think about it, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Keith Parker. Calvin Bynum. Calvin Bynum. Taisha? Here. The rest of the Bynums? Okay, all right. It's a whole lot of y'all. All right.
Okay, Chairman, there are some names on the back.
Yeah, I just flipped the page.
Okay.
J.E. Group.
Good evening, Chairman, Vice Chair Rooks, and Commissioners. This is a very, very serious matter now. My name is Prince Timothy Vondell Jefferson, and I have gotten death threats. They're coming via Texas, so on and so forth. So I just like to send a message that the director of my security is here. Would you stand, sir? And it's Shalom Cowan. I don't know where the death threats are coming from. I would talk to Chief Porter or Deputy Chief so we can find out who's sending these threats. But I'm following up on my presentation on the Plex Arena and the revenue generator. I, as I espoused upon, I have now have exclusive IP rights. IP rights that mean intellectual property rights. Esquire Rooks, you might want to inform the board what IP rights are. So with IP rights solid, I feel comfortable in conversing about the transportation. I have done my due diligence. I have I have a team of about 50 people. I have reached out to Generation Investment LLP out of New York City, which Vice President Al Gore and David Blood started. I have been assigned Shamir DeBar. I have requested that Vice President Gore, President Clinton, Mr. Warren Buffett, and Bill Gates come to this county for a review. And the reason I requested that, Kip Marshall is the Vice President of Wells Fargo. I have secured 41 acres for the 50,000-seat arena. I have secured, negotiating River's Edge Golf Course. I will purchase that. I also have secured and purchased in the Association of Black Cardiologists building in South Fulton, where my office would be located, which is a beautiful facility. I, as a businessman, I'm very, very deeply concerned that we are, again, partnering with an entity like MARTA, which is obsolete. I, again, say feel free. I have researched the market. In Australia, I have requested the presence of the CEO of Wells Fargo Bank to come to Clayton County. Also, Shamir DeBar is ready to receive us, Chairman Turner, the CFO, the COO, and Jeff Matako, because this is a nationwide $300 billion project. I live in Clayton County. I want to start the green energy movement here. MARTA is obsolete. I have researched, and there is a solar energy bus called Tendo. It's built in Australia. I have talked to the bank, and I have reached out to Vice President Gore. I want to buy 1,000 at a time, a military acquisition, like they do fighter jets, to house them here in Clayton County. I want to put 300 of those buses on the road, and this is Tendo. It's a solar-powered bus and electric. Now, what this does, this bus holds 47 passengers. Not only does it do that, it goes 125 miles without a recharge. But if the sun is shining, there's no recharge necessary. And it also goes up to 76 miles an hour. I want to cover Spalding County from Griffin to Atlantic Station and all in between. The buses will be running 15 minutes on cycle. Not only that, the solar energy and the green movement, the bus stops hold 30 people that will be AC and heated in the winter, so our citizens don't suffer. They will be sitting in air conditioning in the bus stops. This is the solar movement moving forward, and we don't need MARTA. These buses will not cost the county one dime. There is a $500 billion surplus for movements like this. This will be a nonprofit called the Spirit of Excellence Bus Transit System that will not cost them the county a dime.
Mr. Jefferson.
And I'm willing to give 5 seats to the board for each district.
Mr. Jefferson.
And the chairman.
Your time is
Thank
up.
You. I would like to request a presentation for the next session, and I will get more involved in it. On standby, we need to go to New York, sir. Thank you.
Jean-Claude Bourget.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Unlike my learned person there, I don't know anything about all these other high technology, but I do know about MARTA, okay? So my point is this. I just simply wanted to be noted clearly how many of us, I should say the commissioners, are going for the one penny tax or the half a penny. Because in my thinking, one penny would be what we need to actually get things going properly. Half a penny would be a wasted time, wasted effort. So I like it to be very clearly noted that how many of the commissioners, including you, Mr. Chairman, wish to vote for the, proposing the one penny or the half a penny. Because I think if we decide to do something, let's do it right. I believe MARTA in this county right now would really help and increase the economic development of this city. We've got a phenomenal county. All the benefits were presented before, the best water system, you know, going in this county. We've got amenities. I've been here for 17 years, by the way, living here, and I'm not moving. I mean, Mr. Dietrich with the park, he's been doing phenomenal work. Every day I get up, I walk, I run, I love it. Where else am I gonna go and do that? So I love this county. I want us to actually really, really do what's right for the county. Let's go ahead and vote for the one penny tax and make this thing happen. Thank you for your time.
Miyoshi Bourget.
And good evening, Ms. Rhodes.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. I've been a proud resident of Clayton County for the past 17 years. And as a resident, I am proud of the many changes that I'm seeing in this county. I see positive changes in Parks and Rec, which is led by Dietrich Stanford, who took over in 2007. He's transforming our parks into attractive destinations that contribute to the quality of life for all of the Clayton County residents. I'm proud of our Clayton County Water Authority that's led by Mike Thomas, which earned top honors in water distribution and collection in 2013. We have one of the best water systems in the region. And I'm also proud of Clayton County Emergency Management Agency under the direction of Chief Landry Merkinson. The EMA recently was awarded the prestigious 2013 Emergency Management Agency of the Year Award, which recognized the county's emergency preparedness. If I were to give Mr. Stanford, Mr. Thomas, and Chief Merkinson grades for their job performances, I'd give them an A. As I look around this county, I also see shuttered storefronts and vacant businesses which dot the landscape of my beloved county. On any given day, approximately 100,000 people travel from outside the county into Clayton County to work here. And how much of that money is spent by those employees in our county? I would venture to say very little. Why? Because Clayton County offers few outlets where that money can be spent. To illustrate, today at 6 o'clock, Old Navy on Mount Zion Road closed, and it's only to reopen tomorrow morning, two exits down in Henry County. Economic development in this county is led by Grant Wainscott, who has been our economic development and film director since 2009. According to Mr. Wayne Scott's resume, he is responsible for overseeing more than $250 million in development and redevelopment projects, incentive districts, and industrial site selection within the Department of Economic Development. What is Mr. Wayne Scott doing with $250 million earmarked for redevelopment in this county? Could it be that Mr. Wayne Scott is secretly working for Henry County to recruit businesses to their county, to a county in which he lives? If I were to give Mr. Wayne Scott a job grade for his job performance, I would give him an F. As we look forward to reestablishing transit in this county, we must plan for economic development because transit and economic development go hand in hand. However, we must have a leader who is aggressively working for Clayton County, not against it, in the areas of business recruitment and retention. MARTA is an example of what a system can become with the right leadership. We need a change in leadership in Economic Development Office. We need a strong visionary leader who knows how to leverage the assets in this county and knows how to make it an attractive economic destination. In the past 5 years, Mr. Wayne Scott has proven he is not that leader. Thank you.
Mr. Merchant, are you here for the zoning hearing, or are you here for the public comment? Okay, thank you. Madam Clerk.
Okay, at this time, I'd like the commissioners to step down, please, for a presentation of several proclamations. And the first is the observance of May 2014 as National Water Safety Month. Would ask Dietrich Stanford, Director of Parks and Recreation, and his staff to please come forward. And this proclamation reads as follows. Whereas the Clayton County Board of Commissioners recognizes the vital role that swimming and aquatic related activities play in physical and mental health by enhancing the overall quality of life for individuals. And whereas the Clayton County Board of Commissioners understands the essential role that education regarding the topic of water safety plays in preventing recreation water related injuries. And whereas the Parks and Recreation Department adheres to the standards set forth by the recreational water industry as represented by the National Recreation and Park Association, the Association of Pool and Spa Professionals, and the World Water Park Association. These standards focus on developing safe swimming facilities, aquatic programs and related activities, providing healthy places to recreate, growth and development, self-esteem building, confidence, and a sense of self-worth, all contributing to the quality of life in our community. And whereas the Parks and Recreation Department recognizes the ongoing efforts and commitment to educating the public on pool and water safety issues and initiatives. And whereas the Clayton County Board of Commissioners understands the importance of communicating water safety rules and programs to Clayton County families and individuals of all ages, whether owners of private pools, users of public swimming facilities, or visitors to water parks. Now, therefore, I, Jeffrey E. Turner, Chairman, on behalf of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim the month of May 2014 as National Water Safety Month in Clayton County, Georgia. In witness thereof, I have hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of Clayton County, Georgia to be affixed this 20th day of May in the year 2014. Jeffrey E. Turner, Chairman. Okay, and we have another observance of this month, this one being Community Action Month. We'd like to call forward Beachy Yates, Interim Executive Director of Community Services Authority, Inc. and staff, if she's here. Whereas community action agencies were created when the Economic Opportunity Act of 1964 was signed into law, and whereas community action agencies have a 50-year history of promoting self-sufficiency for the limited income, and whereas community action agencies have made an essential contribution to individuals and families in Georgia by providing them with innovative and cost-effective programs, and whereas community action agencies are needed as major participants in the reform of the welfare system as we know it, and whereas welfare reform in Georgia has benefited from the state's partnership with community action agencies, and whereas the limited income continue to need opportunities to improve their lives and their living conditions, thus ensuring that all citizens are able to live in dignity, and whereas Clayton County, the state of Georgia, and the entire United States must continue to promote economic security by providing support and opportunities for all citizens in need of assistance. Now, therefore, I, Jeffrey E. Turner, Chairman, on behalf of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim May 2014 as Community Action Month in Clayton County, Georgia. I encourage all citizens to join me in recognizing the hard work and dedication of the Clayton County Community Services Authority and other community action agencies. In witness thereof, I have hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of Clayton County, Georgia to be affixed this 20th day of May in the year 2014. Jeffrey E. Turner, Chairman. Okay, and we've been anticipating the arrival of this young gentleman for quite a while now. It's the recognition of Philip J. Watson as the 2014 Jonesboro High School Star Student, presented by Commissioner Michael Edmondson. And if we have the principal of Jonesboro High School, Miss Felicia Brown, we'd ask that she come up. Parent, Miss Phyllis Watson. And the counselor, Ms. Davenport, and a school board member? Okay. All right. All of you are welcome to come up too. Thank you. Thank you. and Philip's proclamation reads as follows. Whereas Philip J. Watson was chosen as the 2014 star student for Jonesboro High School, and whereas a proper education for the young people of this state and county is the single most important objective of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners. And whereas Philip J. Watson has shown academic accomplishment that the pursuit and attainment of scholastic success are within the reach of the students in this state and county. And whereas a gifted student at Jonesboro High School, this remarkable scholar has been recognized for superlative achievement and selected as Jonesboro High School's 2014 star student. And whereas to be selected as a star student for a high school, a student must have obtained the highest score in one administration of the three-part scholastic aptitude test and be in the top 10% or top 10 students of his or her own class. And whereas each school has one star student who in turn has the opportunity to choose a star teacher who has been inspiring and encouraging throughout that student's high school career. And whereas educator Jeff Cox was chosen by Philip J. Watson as Jonesboro High School's 2014 star teacher for the great support and guidance provided to Philip throughout the years. And whereas Philip has personified the selfless dedication, mental agility, verbal adroitness, and personal maturity necessary for superlative academic performance. And whereas the state of Georgia and the county of Clayton looks with great anticipation toward the future of this bright and promising young citizen. And therefore, I, Michael L. Edmondson, Commissioner, on behalf of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, do hereby recognize and acknowledge Philip J. Watson as Jonesboro High School's star student for 2014. And the proclamation reads on as, and I encourage the citizens of Clayton County to join me in expressing to him our most sincere and best wishes for continued academic success in the future. In witness thereof, I have hereto set my hand and cause the seal of Clayton County, Georgia to be affixed this 20th day of May in the year 2014. Michael L. Edmondson, Commissioner. Okay, next we progress to recognition and honoring the Drew High School 2014 Lady Titans Regional Basketball Champions. This is in Commissioner Gail Hambrick's district. Thank you. Whereas the Charles Drew High School girls basketball team, known as the Lady Titans, finished this season as the Region 4 5A champions with an overall record of 25-4 and advanced to the Final Four of the Georgia State basketball tournament. And whereas under the leadership of head coach Cadence Jackson, principal Gary Townsend, athletic director Jarrett Laws, assistant coaches Chris Smith, Crystal Moody, and Kent, is this Slocum or Slocum? Slocum. As well as team manager Kenesha Robinson, the Lady Titans team has established a tradition of excellence on the court and in the classroom, based upon the principles of hard work, teamwork, discipline, and dedication. Coach Jackson received the Atlanta Journal-Constitution Southside Girls Basketball Coach of the Year Award, the Clayton County Girls Basketball Coach of the Year Award, and the Region 4 5A Coach of the Year Award. And whereas senior Lakia Sims was voted Clayton County Player of the Year. Additionally, she was selected as a member of the Region 4 5A and Atlanta Journal-Constitution All-State First Teams, participant in the Georgia Coaches Athletic Association Senior All-Star Game, and recipient of the Charles Drew High School George Sutherland Sportsmanship Award. Lakia will be attending Palm Beach State College in Lake Worth, Florida. Senior Imani Richards will be joining the Armed Forces. Other team members include freshmen Naya Johnson and Asia Travis, sophomores Jada Hargrove and Selena Robinson, and juniors Destiny Brady, Shateria Gayden, Alexis Henderson, Tamaya Holloway, Alexis Hunt, Rakia Jackson, and Toxiana Wilson. Now, therefore, I, Gilby Hambrick, Commissioner, on behalf of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, do hereby celebrate the Charles Drew High School Lady Titans, as well as the coaches, support staff, and parents who have helped the team members become outstanding ambassadors for Clayton County. They are a shining example and true representation of the kind of students and athletes our county is producing. In witness thereof, I have hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of Clayton County, Georgia, to be affixed this 20th day of May in the year 2014. Gail B. Hambrick, Commissioner. Okay, next, Commissioner Sona Singleton and the board would like to recognize the Mount Zion High School boys track and field team. Thank you. And this reads, whereas the Mount Zion High School boys track and field team was crowned the 2014 Georgia Class 5A state champions, defeating nearly 50 other schools for the honor, including top programs like Stevenson High School of DeKalb County, Union Grove High School of Henry County, and New Manchester High School of Douglas County. And whereas Mount Zion's 1600 meter relay squad, made up of Andrew Insuck, Jonathan Ross, Joshua Simmons, and Marquette Simmons, won first place in that event at the state championships. Additionally, Mount Zion won the Clayton County Championship and the Georgia Region 4-5A Championship. And whereas the Mount Zion High School boys track and field team is led by head coaches Charles Battles, who also serves as athletic director, and George Waters, and assistant coaches Tarina Lewis and Taisha Wilson, with support from Principal Melver Blocker II and assistant principals Kimberly Grant, C. Michael Howes Jr., and Prince T. Bowie. And whereas the state champion Mount Zion High School boys track and field team is comprised of seniors Jeremiah Barber, Charles Barksdale, Willie Green, Javon Jordan, Andrew Insuck, Stephen Pope, Renard Snell, Leander Williams, Marquise Williams, Anthony Wynn, as well as Jonathan Ross and Marquette Simmons, both of whom have been awarded track scholarships to Limestone College, juniors Tyree Brown, Nicholas Burke, Quintavious Busses, Chris Castleberry, Raheem Collier, Joshua Davis, Keon Hobbs, Isaac Erojan, Randy Janikin, Trey Kennedy, John McBride, Javon Agnew Igbo, Joshua Simmons, Daniel Taylor, Austin Van Valen, Kirkland Varnado, sophomore Timothea Slade, and freshman Cedric Plim, Stephen Shintini, Justin Taburn, and Takia Tinsley. Now, therefore, I, Sona Singleton, Commissioner, on behalf of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, do hereby honor this outstanding accomplishment by the Mount Zion High School boys track and field team, a group of impressive young men who are true representatives of Clayton County. In witness thereof, I have hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of Clayton County, Georgia, to be affixed this 20th day of May in the year 2014. Sona Singleton, Commissioner. This time, we'd like to recognize our own Clayton County Convention and Visitors Bureau. Any representatives, please come forward from the Bureau, please. Whereas, according to the Georgia Department of Economic Development Tourism Division, Clayton County ranks fourth in Georgia for overall tourism economic impact at $1.166 billion last year. The local taxes generated by tourism in Clayton County are $31.87 million, saving each household in Clayton County $1,925 because of tourism expenditures. And whereas, in celebration of the 75th anniversary of Gone with the Wind and the designation of the Gone with the Wind Trail, the Georgia Department of Economic Development Tourism Division honored Clayton County with the distinction of being featured on the cover of the 2014 Georgia Travel Guide, the first time in over 25 years of the Georgia Travel Guide's publication that Clayton County has been on the cover. And whereas this honor is a testament to the hard work and dedication of the professionals at the Clayton County Convention and Visitors Bureau, With the CVB's commitment to providing current and accurate information to our visitors to increase their stay in Clayton County, thus increasing revenue for the county, the CVB staff has increased the communication with each of the attractions in Clayton County and promotes them through advertising, social media, calendar listings, and media releases. And whereas through the sales and marketing efforts of the CVB, international visitation increased over 28% in 2013, with visitors from 43 countries, with the majority of them coming from Germany, the United Kingdom, Norway, Sweden, and Canada. Domestic visitation has continued a steady increase of 3.5% as well. And whereas while the purpose of the CVB is to reach visitors beyond Clayton County and to encourage them to stay in our hotels, eat in our restaurants, and shop in our local stores, the CVB realizes that marketing to and serving our local residents is also a priority, as is being a great community partner. Now, therefore, I, Sona Singleton, Commissioner, on behalf of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners, do hereby honor the outstanding work of the Clayton County Convention and Visitors Bureau. In witness thereof, I have hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of Clayton County, Georgia, to be affixed this 20th day of May in the year 2014. Sona Singleton, Commissioner. And lastly, we have two scholarship letters presented by Commissioner Sona Singleton to scholarship recipients in District 1. Would ask both of the recipients to come forward, Matthew Falk and Lauren Jennings. Beg your pardon? Yeah, that's what I'm doing. I'm asking them to come forth like you asked me the last time, have both of them come forth and I'll read them individually. Okay. Of Barra High School. Oh. Okay, all right. Well, we'll call forward Matthew Falk to come first, please, with his friends, family, any representatives from Mara High School and administration. And Matthew's letter reads, congratulations. It is with great pleasure and pride that I present you with a $1,000 scholarship to help you with your college expenses. Your efforts and accomplishments as a student, as a young leader, and as a citizen of Clayton County are outstanding, as illustrated by the fact that you were recently given the Humanitarian Award by your peers in the Mara High School class of 2014 for your community service through the Air Force Junior ROTC, and as a member of Travelers Rest Baptist Church. You are an honor roll student, an Eagle Scout, and a member of the Organization of Black Airline Pilots, as on February 26th of this year, you became a licensed private pilot at the age of 18. And the letter continues to read, accomplishing a goal you set while working on an aviation badge for the Boy Scouts at the age of 12. We wish you great success as you continue to work toward earning your flight instrument rating while pursuing your degree in business management, flight, at Middle Georgia State College for the purpose of becoming a Delta Airlines pilot. Thank you for being a shining example and true representative of the kind of young people our county is producing. And again, congratulations on your scholarship award. With warmest regards, Sona Singleton, Commissioner, Clayton County Board of Commissioners.
Okay.
And finally, we call forth Ms. Lauren Jennings, her family, any friends, okay, and school administrators. And Lauren's letter reads, "Dear Lauren, congratulations. It is with great pleasure and pride that I present you with a $1,000 scholarship to help you with your college expenses. Your efforts and accomplishments as a student, as a young leader, and as a citizen of Clayton County are outstanding. You have maintained a grade point average of 3.5 or higher with a schedule that includes honors and advanced placement courses at Mara High School, where you will graduate with honors in the top 10% of your class. Additionally, you have won numerous awards and honors at local, county, and state social science fairs, been a governor's honors finalist, was awarded the Outstanding Attorney Award for the Mara High School Mock Trial Team by the Georgia Association of Mock Trials, were nominated to become a member of the National Society of High School Scholars for the year 2013 through 2014, and held the office of treasurer in the National Beta Club. Furthermore, you have received letters of congratulation and commendations from United States Congressman David Scott, and been nominated for the Georgia State School Superintendent's Advisory Council. We wish you great success as you pursue degrees in education and psychology at Georgia State University. Thank you for being a shining example and true representative of the kind of young people our county is producing. And again, congratulations on your scholarship award. With warmest regards, Sona Singleton Commissioner, Clayton County Board of Commissioners." Thank you, everybody, for your indulgence. This time, we will resume our regular business meeting items. Next is the consideration of requests of Carol Rogers, Contract Compliance Manager of Central Services.
Please take them all together.
Thank you. Good evening. Good evening. I have 8 requests for Central Services. The first request is Central Services would like to obtain the necessary approval from the Board of Commissioners to dispose of county assets by utilizing our contract with govdeals.com. We have a lot of 34 items with varying quantities inside. I respectfully request your approval of this recommendation. Next item is for Deferred Prosecution Program for Clayton County Annual Contract, RFP Package Number 14-08. This proposal is for an annual contract for deferred prosecution programs as requested by the Clayton County's District Attorney. The evaluation committee consisted of county representatives from the District Attorney's Office, Juvenile Justice, and Solicitor's Office have reviewed the proposals. The District Attorney's recommendation is to issue a multi-award contract to the following vendors: The Road to Recovery, Inc., located in Forest Park, Georgia, with the highest score of 475. Clayton Center Community Service Board, located in Jonesboro, Georgia, with the second highest score of 469. And NNK Consulting, LLC, located in College Park, Georgia, with the third highest score of 443. This project is funded by the participants, therefore there will be no cost to the county. The tabulation summary, department recommendation, and agreements for the above reference proposal are attached for your review and recommendation. I request you approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman and his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget accordingly. Next item is agreement for Bolitor Solution Equipment. The Board of Commissioners approved this sole source purchase from Election System and Software, located in Omaha, Nebraska, during the Board of Commissioners meeting on May the 6th, 2014. This request is to approve the agreement for this purchase. The agreement, department recommendation memo, purchase order requisition, sole source letter, and quote for the above reference request are attached for your review and recommendation. I request you approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman and his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget accordingly. Next item is for RFB package number 11-43, sports photography services for Clayton County Parks and Recreation, annual contract, First Amendment request for price increase. The Parks and Recreation Director's request is to amend the current annual contract with Score Photo Inc., located in Kennesaw, Georgia, with the increase in pricing of 5% of the current bid of $17.75 for a total of $18.63. The final renewal period will be from June the 1st, 2014 to May the 31st, 2015. The Board of Commissioners approved this proposal on April the 10th, 2012. The department's recommendation memo, vendor renewal acceptance, and agreement amendment for the above reference project have been attached for your review. I request you approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman and his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget accordingly. Next item is for RFB package number 12-04, Clayton County Firefighter Turnout and Protective Gear Annual Contract, amendment request for price increase. The fire chief's request is to amend the current annual contract with Bennett Fire Products Company, located in Woodstock, Georgia, with an increase in pricing. Bennett Fire Products Company was originally awarded the contract by the Board of Commissioners on April the 3rd, 2012. The final renewal period will be from May the 1st, 2014 to April the 30th, 2015. Bennett Fire Products Company has agreed to accept the amendment. There is a price increase of 6 items with the average of $24. The department recommendation, vendor renewal acceptance with the cost comparison and agreement amendment for the above reference project has been attached for your review. I request you approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman and his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget accordingly. Next item is for RFB package number 13-11. That's for Clayton County Solid Waste Service Annual Contract, First Amendment Request. The warden's request is to amend the current annual contract with Waste Pro of Georgia, located in Doraville, Georgia. The renewal period will be from June the 1st, 2014 to May the 31st, 2015. The remaining renewal on this contract is for one additional one-year period. The Board of Commissioners approved this bid on April the 16th, 2013. The department recommendation, vendor renewal acceptance, and agreement amendment for the above reference project have been attached for your review. I request you approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman and his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the Chief Financial Officer to amend the budget accordingly. Next item is for RFB package number 13-17. This is for concession operations at the Clayton County International Park annual contract, First Amendment request. The Parks and Recreation Director's request is to amend the current annual contract with NEA-BBQ LLC, doing business as Sonny's Barbecue, located in Beaufort, Georgia. The renewal period will be from June 1, 2014 to May 31, 2015. The remaining renewal on this contract is for one additional year, 1 year period. The Board of Commissioners approved this project on May 14, 2013. The department recommendation, vendor renewal acceptance, and agreement amendment for the above referenced project have been attached for your review. I request you approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman and his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget accordingly. Next and last item is for RFB package number 14-31. This is for athletic uniforms and equipment for the Clayton County Parks and Recreation Department. This bid is for an annual contract for athletic uniforms and equipment as requested by the Director of Parks and Recreation. The Director's recommendation is to award a contract to Four Seasons Sporting Goods, Inc., located in College Park, Georgia. This recommendation is based upon the lowest responsive bidder that meets the qualifications and specifications of Parks and Recreation Department. Funding is available through the Parks and Recreation 2014 general budget. The tabulation summary, department recommendation memorandum, and agreement for the above referenced bid are attached for your review and information. I request you approve the recommendation, authorize the chairman and his designee to execute all necessary documents to accomplish the intent of the contract, and authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget accordingly.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Properly moved and second. Are there any questions on any of the items? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
The board will now consider requests of Ramona Thurman, Chief Financial Officer.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I have seven items for your consideration this evening. Budget Amendment 4-84. Is for SPOS 2009 to amend the budget in the amount of $19,821 to purchase a video storage server for site security for the Public Safety Digital Network project. Budget Amendment 4-85 is from SPOS 2009 to amend the budget in the amount of $9,400 to purchase equipment needed to gain access to newly acquired green space and trail properties throughout the park system. 4-86 is for 2004 Roads and Recreation SPOS to amend the budget in the amount of $2,700 for environmental testing of the Independence Park site for the at-large recreation center. 4-87 is 2009 SPOS to amend the budget in the amount of $44,990 for the beach fencing project at Clayton County International Park. 4-88 is 2009 SPOST to amend the budget in the amount of $161,316 for the pavilions and front entrance wall renovation project at Clayton County International Park. 4-89 is 2009 SPOST to amend the budget in the amount of $175,000 for additional funds needed for the bridge maintenance project land cost. 4-90 is 2009 SPOST to amend the budget in the amount of $15,000 for the Panhandle Road turn lane at Eddie White Academy project. Funds are needed for the right-of-way acquisition services and land cost.
Do I have a motion?
I move that we accept the request.
Is there a second?
Second.
Properly moved and second. Are there any questions on any of the items? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Next, the board will consider requests of Renee Bright, Director of Human Resources.
I have three items tonight.
The first is a request to renew the self-funded medical plan stop-loss coverage for plan year June 1st, 2014 through May 31st, 2015. Human Resources recommends moving the plan from HCC to Symetra with no plan changes and no increase in premium.
Take them all together, please.
The next is a request from the police chief to reclassify a vacant police officer position and to create a community relations officer position at a pay grade 21. This will allow the department to employ an individual who has the background and experience in media relations, marketing, and community outreach, and this will be budget neutral. Finally, I have a request to revise the class specification for the director's central services to include risk management responsibilities and to remove those duties from the director of human resources classification.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
I'll second it. Properly moved and second. Any questions on any of the items? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Okay, and at this time, the board will hear from Chief Staff Attorney Christy Barnes.
Good evening, Mr. Excuse Commissioner, me. Members of the board.
Mr. Chairman, can yes. we take 126 separate, please?
126 separately.
Is that 126, Ms. Hamburg?
Yes.
Okay.
First is ordinance number 2014-119, which is an ordinance to amend the Code of Clayton County, Georgia, as amended, specifically Code of Clayton County, Georgia, Part 2, Chapter 2, Administration, Article 1, in general, by deleting the existing Section 2-6, Travel Outside County, and substituting in lieu thereof a new Section 2-6, Employee Travel, to repeal conflicting laws, ordinances, and resolutions, to provide severability, to provide an effective date, and for other purposes. Next is resolution number 2014-120, which you should have all received an updated copy, which is an ordinance to amend the Code of Clayton County, Georgia, as amended, specifically Code of Clayton County, Georgia, Part 2, Chapter 62, Offenses and Miscellaneous Provisions, Article 1, General, by adding a new section 62-47, keeping a disorderly place, to repeal conflicting laws, ordinances, and resolutions, to provide for severability, to provide an effective date of this ordinance, and for other purposes. Next is resolution number 2014-121, which will provide for the restatement of the Clayton County Board of Commissioners Premium Conversion Flexible Benefit Plan to include the Flexible Spending Account, Health Spending Account, and Dependent Care Account for plan year June 1st, 2014, to authorize the chairman to execute any documents necessary to accomplish the intent of this resolution, to provide an effective date of this resolution, and for other purposes. Resolution number 2014-122 is a resolution which will authorize Clayton County, on behalf of Clayton County Library Services, to enter into an agreement with the University System of Georgia, on behalf of Clayton State University, to provide a federal work-study program, to authorize the chairman to execute the agreement and otherwise to perform all other acts necessary to accomplish the intent of this resolution, to provide an effective date of this resolution, and for other purposes. Resolution number 2014-123 is a resolution which will authorize Clayton County to enter into a performance agreement with Solid Soul Band Phase 2, providing for the terms and conditions under which live entertainment will be performed at the J. Charlie Griswold Senior Center, to authorize the chairman to execute the agreement and otherwise perform all acts necessary to accomplish the intent of this resolution, to authorize the chief financial officer to amend the budget where necessary to reflect an appropriate revenue source and expense, to provide an effective date of this resolution, and for other purposes. Resolution number 2014-124 is a resolution to terminate a lease agreement for property located at 7535 South Lake Parkway in Clayton County, to authorize the chairman to execute any necessary documents and otherwise to perform all acts necessary to accomplish the intent of this resolution, to provide an effective date of this resolution, and for other purposes. Resolution number 2014-125 is a resolution to authorize Clayton County to convey property to the city of Jonesboro, Georgia, to authorize the chairman to execute all documents necessary to effectuate the transfer and otherwise to perform all acts necessary to accomplish the intent of this resolution, to provide an effective date of this resolution, and for other purposes.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Probably moved in second. Are there any questions on any of the items? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous.
Ordinance number 2014-126 is an ordinance providing for the additional duties for the chief operating officer, to provide an effective date of this ordinance, and for other purposes.
Is there a motion?
I have a question before motion, please.
Commissioner Hamburg.
Hold on, let me get to this. I have a question. Well, no, I have a suggestion for number three, where it reads about the disciplinary actions. I would like to see that under that same paragraph, but the section, the chief operating officer shall have the authority to investigate allegations regarding department heads and submit a recommendation for demotion, termination, and also for disciplinary actions before the board.
So if I understand you, you want...
Mine didn't open.
I want disciplinary actions brought before us.
So the COO should not have the right to take disciplinary action, such as write-ups, reprimands, written reprimands, or anything like that?
It comes through the... Right, before given to the employee, right. If not all the board, at least whatever commissioners are interested in that. Yes.
I see the commissioner's role as a policymaking board, but is that your motion?
I didn't make a
motion.
Are
you going to amend?
Yes, I would like to amend section three to include under the...
Mr. Chairman, should we have a motion and a second before we make an amendment? And if so, I'd like to make a motion that we... Make a motion that we approve.
Right. That would be the first motion. That's the first motion we've had.
Okay, is there a second on Commissioner Emerson's motion?
Second.
Probably moved and second.
And that's approve as is. Okay.
That's the approve it as is.
Yes. Well, I would like to amend that motion to include to the change in number three, which reads, the chief operating officer shall have the authority to investigate allegations regarding the department directors and to submit a recommendation for the disciplinary actions, demotions, or termination to the Board of Commissioners.
The chief operating officer shall have the authority to investigate
allegations and submit a recommendation for the disciplinary action. I'm just adding disciplinary actions along with the motions or termination.
Yeah, do you want that to be or to any commissioner who's interested?
What, to the commission? To the commissioners,
to the board.
And then we can decide whatever commissioner is interested or not, yes.
So the recommendation will be made to the board?
To the board, okay. Yes.
Okay, is there a second to Commissioner Hambricks?
I second, Mr. Chair.
All right. Any other discussion on the second motion? Hearing none. Those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? Nay.
Nay.
3-2.
That was the motion to amend that did not pass.
The amendment did not pass.
Correct.
No.
Because there's three in opposition and two in favor.
That's correct.
And on the approval as is, what was the vote on that?
No, we're about
to
take it.
We haven't voted yet.
That's what I thought. Okay.
You have a motion and a second.
Now, on the original motion, are there any questions? Hearing none, those in favor, aye.
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 Opposed?
Nay.
So that's three in favor and two in opposition?
That's correct.
So that passed as is?
That's correct.
Okay.
And, Mr. Chairman, I need an executive session for our litigation and personnel.
Thank you.
Okay. Next, we have a discussion item. It's reconsideration of an appointee, James Fambro, to the Clayton County Housing Authority. The term of Kenneth Gilmore expired on May 11th of this year, New term would be for 5 years, expiring May 11th of 2019. Ms. Hamburg, did you have some comments to make at this time?
Yes, I do. I would like to refer to my email to the chairman, along with the copies of to the commissioners regarding, and can I read this as far as legal or, well, what I would like to do is to have the, Christy, if you would give us your findings regarding the questions I had in my email to the commissioners.
Yes, ma'am. I was recently asked, excuse me for sitting. I was recently asked to provide a report to the Board of Commissioners regarding James Fambro and his actions involving a former Clayton County employee. And for privacy and HIPAA purposes, I'm going to refrain from using the employee's name. I was ultimately able to locate a file in our office that contained an undated letter from an organization called the Concerned Citizens of Clayton County. The letter was undated and is also unsigned. The person who wrote the letter indicated being at the commission office often and noticing two employees taking two-hour lunches and coming to work between 10 a.m. and 12 noon. The letter also states these employees were being paid for 8 hours or more based on timesheet entries. The letter referenced one employee's use of sick leave and clocking in late without being disciplined. I searched the county's meeting minutes and found the minutes from November 6, 2012, where Mr. Fambro spoke during the public comment. Mr. Fambro's comment contained most of what was contained in the unsigned letter that's in our file.
What was that date again?
The minutes of the meeting were from November 6, 2007.
Oh, okay. I thought you said 12.
She did say 12.
Did I say 12?
She said 12.
I said
12, so it's 2007? Okay.
Yes, I apologize. Our office was then asked to research whether the county could seek a temporary protective order on the employee's behalf. And our office researched this issue and responded by stating that an employer may seek a temporary restraining order pursuant to state law where an employee has suffered unlawful violence or a credible threat of violence from any individual which can reasonably be construed to have been carried out at the employee's workplace. The same statute goes on to say that nothing in that code section shall be construed as authorizing a court to issue a temporary restraining order or injunction which prohibits free speech or other activities that are protected by the Georgia Constitution or the United States Constitution. Ultimately, the county did not seek a restraining order against Mr. Fambro, but our file contains a letter from one of the county's outside counsel attorneys. The letter was sent to Mr. Fambro asking that he cease and desist with any further conduct.
Thank you.
All right, I have a couple of questions for you. First one, was it involving more than one employee or was he supposedly watching several employees?
The letter indicates that he was watching several, at least three county employees.
And from my understanding at that time, he was part of a Concerned Citizens of Clayton County group who was looking to hold county employees accountable for county time and county pay.
That's who the letter is sent by. That's who the author of the letter is.
I think they're two separate issues. I happen to be in attendance back in 07 when these things were going on. And I don't think that this was a part of the Concerned Citizens of Clayton County. I think these are two separate issues. This was done by this person individually on his own.
Is there a police report to that?
Not to my knowledge.
No police reports filed. Is there anything in writing from the supposed, well, I'm not gonna say supposed, from the employee? Did she make a written request of any sort?
Not to my knowledge.
I have a question. Ms. Hamrick, you weren't even on the board in 2007.
I've been attending meetings here at the Clayton County Commission for years, even when Mr. Turner, Dale Turner, was chairman.
And so and my question is, if I recollect from that time, there was made reference to open records requests as to that employee's timesheets. And I believe at that time, our legal counsel provided those as part of the public record request. Do we know who made that public record request?
The file that we had in our office did not contain those open records requests. So I don't know. I have not seen any open records requests. And
so is there any investigation done as to who was the Concerned Citizens of Clayton County? Or was it ever determined that Mr. Fambro or any other individual was actually the author of that?
Our files do not reflect that Mr. Fambro was a part of the organization. Right. The letter that's in our file is from the concerned citizens,
okay.
And the verbiage in his from the public comment are the same.
Okay. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, to your point, you're saying they were just looking for open and transparency at the time, right?
That's from my understanding. And at that time, I was the chief of police, and it was not brought to my attention, nor was did the employees bring in anything to my attention.
Were the employees women? Can you say that? Women or men? You know, it seemed like to me this was almost, I remember I was on the board, Mr. Emerson, and it almost appeared like stalking to me. I had an incident myself with Mr. Fambro. And it just kind of bothered me. And I'm just adding that to the record.
Okay. Did anybody file a stalking protective order?
Not that I'm aware of.
But this was the knowledge of I think, all the employees that were here in the building.
Exactly.
And also people that were attending the meetings, because it went on from meeting to meeting. Well, basically, to me, seemed like more like harassment or harassing this one employee.
Exactly.
Did you get anything from the employee stating that she felt like she was being harassed or intimidated?
Our anything files do not contain anything in writing to
okay.
that effect.
Did you see anything about Mr. Fambro posting up, I guess, just letters or whatever he that were composed outside? You know, and I just want to say myself, too, you know, Mr. Fambro even came down when they made allegations that I had county workers working on my roof in my house. I just want to add that to the record.
Okay, is there anything further? Mr. Fambro is here. Would you like to say something in your own defense, sir?
I'll certainly say it. Well, I didn't make
state
that allegation.
State your name, your full name for
my name is James Fambro. I did not make that allegation. 200 people made that allegation. And I've been looking for that picture. There's a picture somewhere.
That's what I'm looking for
safe.
Too.
Ms. Fambro, we're not going to go back and forth individual.
Rate,
if you want to make a statement, please
I
make
do.
A statement.
And that is one
at
of the things
that,
he
after
claimed to have a picture,
being
which
asked
is a
by
lie.
Some concerned citizens to do a study about the Clayton Commission employees being late and having lunch more than 2 hours and more, I found out as I was doing that was happening. I made an open records request for time cards. They gave me time sheets. I put a second request in for time cards. And as the time cards, I went over time cards, that is exactly what was happening. Never received any letter from anyone. And that, as I was researching that, I did find that one of the commissioners was having one of the employees here pick up and take home the office manager at that particular time. Don't know which one was doing that, but I did get a call from Ms. Singleton to say that they had fired that particular person that particular day, because I had called the director of personnel, Renee Bright. And,
I called you?
Please let him speak, Commissioner.
And after I called her, that's when the action started. They fired that particular person. She called me, said that they had fired her and they escorted off the property. So I am just a person here trying to make sure that all these...
He's delusional.
That it's transparent. Okay. I just wanted that to be on the record as well. I'm also as qualified as anybody up there to be on any board or whatever. Because the difference between some of these people on the commission and me is that I'm honest, truthful, and for what's right.
I would like to make a comment too that during the time of his sitting out in the parking lot watching this employee and all back and forth, this lady was suffering from cancer.
Right. No, sir. No, sir. We don't need to talk about
that. That's one thing to say. I have, my wife
and
has.
Ms. Barnes, that's subject to HIPAA.
We should refrain from saying.
We didn't call the employee's name.
No.
My wife has Lou Gehrig's disease. I take care of her every single day. So,
Thank you. Well, one of the things I'm going to clear up for the record, if just in case anybody want to go out and say anything, no county employees ever worked on my house, for the record, Mr. Fanbro. And I've also received reports of a car looking like Mr. Fanbro sitting outside of my house. Again,
is that for
y'all
the
need
record?
To consider who you're putting on the boards.
Okay, is there anything coming out of this discussion? Is there a motion on your part?
Yes, my motion would be to rescind the appointment of Mr. Fanbro to the Housing Authority.
I'll second it.
Probably moved and second. Any other discussion?
I do. I have a question.
Okay.
Of course, I wasn't on the board.
Commissioner
Rhodes. But I do have concern that we have citizens who are allowed, because we are their employees, they implore us to monitor whether or not employees are stealing time. I think that's what the allegations are. So if a citizen can do that, why is that germane to whether or not they can sit on the board? That's my concern.
Well, I was concerned about harassment.
It seems like a slippery slope if we say, because you are, as a citizen, a taxpayer of this county, you want to hold us accountable. You can't hold us accountable, and if you do, you can't be on a board. I just think I'm a little concerned about that. And I don't know any of the parties. I'm just concerned that we are doing that.
Well, if you were here, and I used to be in attendance at those meetings, and it was really overboard. To me, it bordered on harassment.
And I feel the same way, you know, knowing the employee at that time and seeing what she went through and being a female myself and the emotional trauma that she went through. Yeah, you would think twice. And she had confided in me several times about the actions.
Is that it? All right. Those in favor, aye.
What are we voting on?
Your motion.
Was to rescind, Ms. Hambrick.
Right, about the rescission, yes.
Mm-hmm. The rescission. Your motion was to rescind.
Right.
And Ms. Singleton seconded it. We need a vote.
Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
So that was 3 in favor and 2 in opposition?
Yes, ma'am.
So it stands? Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Let me be clear. There was a motion for to rescind. It was 2 in favor, 3 in opposition to rescind.
Yes.
Right. So the motion did not pass.
Oh, okay. Say that again. 2 in favor.
And 3 opposed.
And 3, that's right, in opposition.
So
okay, to rescind. That's right. Okay. Thank you.
The appointment stands.
The appointment stands as is.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, the next section is devoted to 2 zoning petitions. The first is Lee Mayweather. With the petition to step forward at this time. Mr. Mayweather is requesting a rezoning from neighborhood business district to community business district to allow for gasoline sales. This would be for a convenience store as the anchor tenant of a retail shopping plaza upon property located at 1489 Mundy's Mill Road in Jonesboro. And the subject property is approximately 4.2 acres of land, currently zoned neighborhood business. It lies in Commission District 3, Commissioner Shana Rooks. Before the commissioner speaks, I'd like to ask, is there any opposition to this particular petition? Okay, did each of you sign a zoning card to speak before the board following the petitioner's presentation? Okay, and so when you come up, please give that card to me. All right, are you Mr. Mayweather?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead and speak, please.
Hi, my name is Lee Mayweather. I'm the applicant for KMS Mundy Mill for the rezoning application at 1489 Mundy's Mill Road. This is a existing store. It's a convenience store with several retail shops. And the owner and the owner is wishing to rezone it simply to sell gasoline. That's what we wish to do, sell gasoline. They have 4 stations out there. Again, like I said, the station, the store is empty, and it has been empty for several months. And we've made the application for the rezoning. A couple of months ago, we met with the Clayton County staff, and we went over and we received their list of zoning, their concerns. And we also received a list from their staff, the transportation staff. What they indicated was that we could not see any detrimental cause of traffic, of water, sewer, that by adding 4 stations would make. What we did read was that there may be some contamination, but the state fire marshal makes that ruling, no one else. He has to make that ruling. The owner has quite a few convenience stores, gasoline stations, in and around the state of Georgia. We've been very successful in renovating stations and bringing them back to life. I worked on probably 10 plus with this particular owner in and around the state of Georgia. So we met with the BOC, the Citizen Advisory, and we're aware that it's been denied, but we just can't find the reasoning from a technical point of view other than the citizens of that community does not want it. That's the only reason we can find it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Who's in opposition?
And those in opposition?
Those in opposition, please come forward.
Okay. But one at a time. This gentleman, if you'll give me your card.
What's his name? Mr. Mayweather?
Lee Mayweather.
Yes. Okay. And you're welcome to pass that out to the commissioners.
Oh, you have a copy for everybody. Okay.
Just give me the whole stack and I'll pass them down.
Is that the petition that's attached to this already?
Oh,
another one.
No, they're different.
We have 794 petitions.
Good evening.
Please state your name.
My name is Rajpal Pateja, and I represent 1480 Mundy's Mill Road and 9853 Tara Boulevard in this matter. Since I moved from India, Clayton County has been my home. I've operated a business at this location since 1993. I've been a part of this community all along. As a concerned citizen of this community, along with 784 petitioners who are voting citizens of the county, we object to the rezoning of the property for use as a gas station for the following reasons. Traffic during rush hour and school times gets very congested on Mundy's Mill Road. There is a very busy daycare center and a middle school on either side of this property. There's also a high school at the opposite end of Mundy's Mill Road. The additional traffic caused by this gas station will create hazardous conditions for the community. And Mr. Mayweather just now said that there is an existing convenience store. There is nothing there. Okay. Next, I would like to bring up is the contamination. The 1480s Mundy's Mill Road is right opposite to this property. That property has groundwater deep well. I am concerned about the contamination that can take place. Mr. Mayweather in the last meeting had mentioned that double-walled underground tanks and leak detectors can be a safeguard against those things. It doesn't exactly work that way. Leak detectors can only work after the problem. They only can tell you that you have a problem. They do not stop the problem. I can give you examples of two stations which, while in operation, they did not even know that they had a contamination. They got foreclosed because of slow economic conditions last year. One was at the intersection of State Route 138 and Mount Zion Parkway, a very busy store at one time. They got foreclosed. The bank took over. They did the contamination work on their own for their safety and found contamination. The contamination was not detected while it was in operation. Another one at the intersection of Buddy Road and 1941. Same thing. The bank took over, they did the work, they found the contamination, but the operators did not find one. So as such, you know, no matter, I operate one gas station, so I know, you know, these things do happen. So it's not that it cannot happen. And as I've mentioned earlier, it's not just myself in opposition. There are 784 members of the community who do not want this gas station at that location. And most of them are residents of zip code 30236 and 30238. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next.
Opposition.
Is there anyone else here who would like to speak in opposition? Nobody else liking to speak. Mr. Mayweather, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Again, my name is Lee Mayweather, and as the gentleman indicated, he came here from India in pursuit of the American dream, and we welcome open arms. I'm a U.S. citizen. I lived here in Clayton County for 27 years before I moved a little further north. My kids went to North Clayton Elementary, Northcutt Elementary, and proudly they graduated from North Clayton High School. But we here again. We welcome arms with him from another country, and he's the owner of one of those gas stations up at that corner, I believe. Okay, so he cannot deny us the American right to pursue our own endeavors for a business, simply because he has a gas station up there. I have letters here from companies that are in the double wall and in the tank construction. These tanks will be double wall fiberglass constructed with leak detections. They're all now required by the EPA. This is a requirement now. This is governed by the state fire marshal. The state fire marshal has to make that determination about these tanks. No one else can. Thank you.
Are you in opposition?
Where are you at about 5 seconds ago when I asked for opposition?
But don't they have 3 minutes each?
They can speak. Come on down, sir.
So there you go. With no cap.
Yep. With a total of 10 minutes for each side.
Exactly. Okay. Opposition and in favor.
No, he was saying the cap on the time.
Oh. Okay. Is that Freddie Heron?
Okay. Oh,
he said the cap on the time. He didn't mean your cap.
For 10 minutes, you can wear that cap.
I've been on, excuse me, my name is Freddie Heron. I live at 1218 Pond Place, right off of Munders Mill. My grandkids go to school at Munders Mill, middle school, Munders Mill High. Now, I am an American citizen, but we have two service stations, Shell on one, Exxon on the other. We don't need three. That's the bottom line. That section that this gentleman, Mr. Mayweather, was speaking about, I watched it for the last 17 years. They go and come. Why? Because we already have two convenience stores, the Shell station, the Exxon station, Kroger's, Publix. Bottom line, you set another service station there, like he says, there's a daycare center on one side, Munder Mill Middle School on the other side, and that traffic, when the school zone is there, police officers sitting right there give you a ticket. So we set another service station there. Like I said, I agree, if you want a service station, find it on the other corner. But right there where I live at, it's hard getting to go to work in the morning at 5 o'clock in the morning. That's long getting home in the evening at 6:30. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, sir. The other gentleman, come down. Sir. Yes, come on. Say again.
That's okay, just state your name, that'll be fine, thank you.
Yes, my name is Willie R. McKinnon, Jr.
Can you speak a little into the microphone, yes.
My name is Will R. McKinnon, Jr., and I do live here in Clayton County at O'Hara Village. And as the man say, I'm an American citizen, too, and a war vet. And I came here in 73, and the traffic, like they said, is very heavy. And I know about when they put those, I'm not an engineer, but I got enough sense, common sense to know those things go in the ground, they rot. And once you contaminate the water system, you can forget it. And I just don't trust anything like that. And I just was hoping that you guys just will honor what we wanted to do. He only had 700, but we couldn't get the rest of the folks. So we're just saying no. What's wrong with saying no in your neighborhood? If you want a gas station, I think it's going to turn up to be, you're going to probably put in for some liquor license, and there go the neighborhood. I didn't fight for my country all that to come back home to a ghetto. That's what I left here to do, to fight, to come back and live good. And my hat's off to him being an American citizen. I love America. You see what I'm saying? But I can't let him take mine. Not in my neighborhood. Tell him to put it over in his neighborhood. Now that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Come on. You are in opposition, right?
I am. Sir.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I didn't have a card either, but
that's okay. State
my
your name
is William Mead. I own a property next door to that strip mall. And we already have noise contamination and light contamination, and with a station, I only see that getting worse. And the property values will go lower than they are right now. Like I say, I own a property next door. I don't live there anymore, but I would like to keep it rented. That's all I've got to say.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else in opposition?
What's staff's recommendation?
Staff recommended denial due to the inconsistency with the future land use map and the comprehensive plan.
Is it Mr. Mayweather? You stated that the citizens don't want the gas station. That should be a concern, because if they don't want it, they're not going to patronize your business. And they're not going to patronize a business. We're going to have another store.
Well, there's other stores there.
There's going to be another store that's vacant. So it's the location where you are is really a rock's throw away from those other two gas stations that are on the corner.
But there are other stores there. This is a convenience strip mall. There's about six or seven of the retail stores there. And again, this is the American way, the American dream, to pursue your own goals. We have gas now, $3.59 a gallon, $3.67 a gallon. Okay, they almost have a monopoly on it. So my philosophy is I live off of Camelton Road. Now we probably have six or seven gas stations. You tend to go where the cheapest gas is being sold.
And that's a concern for us, because if we're not patronizing Exxon and Shell, then they're going to go out of business. It's not even a block away from where you are proposing to build.
I doubt Exxon and Shell is going to go out of business. Okay.
All right.
I seriously doubt that.
Okay, anything further?
I don't have anything further. I recommend that we accept Zach's recommendation.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
So that's to deny, right?
Yes.
Probably moved in second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, those in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Okay, and the second zoning petition is Dr. Carol Brady, who is requesting a conditional use permit from Agricultural District to allow for a group home for a residential substance abuse treatment facility to house no more than 10 residents upon property located at 7265 Mount Zion Boulevard in Jonesboro, Georgia. Presently, this group home has a license with no more than 5 residents, and it sits on approximately 2.10 acres of land, currently zoned Agriculture District.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good. My name is Liz Galson. I am the substance abuse counselor at the property in question. And I would just like to speak in favor, obviously, of increasing to 10 patients. As you will hear from the neighbors, they were not aware that we were even located there as a substance abuse treatment facility. And I think that that speaks volumes to the impact that it will have on our neighbors. Our patients have not been a problem. They are monitored 24/7. We haven't had any incidents where any of our patients have left the property and bothered the neighbors or vandalized any property or anything like that. And we have a very well-trained clinical staff that monitors them 24/7. And I just ask for you to approve. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Carol Brady, and I would first like to give honor to God first, who's the head of my life, and to Chairman Turner, to Vice Chair Ms. Rooks, and to the commissioners, the rest, Commissioner Hambrick, Commissioner Edmondson, Commissioner Singleton. I would like to first thank you for allowing us this time. As Liz spoke, we've been licensed for quite some time. We serve juvenile justice as well as the adolescent community. We are contracted with the state of Georgia Department of Juvenile Justice, and we do treat youth with co-occurring disorders or substance abuse. These are young youth who may be committed to the state, many of which live in our county and could be between the ages of 12, 13, 14 years old, and they need a second chance. And we realize that mental illness is heavily in our community, and we have to serve our children. So we have taken the necessary steps to request for approval, and we would ask that the Board of Commissioners consider both the county recommendation as well as the ZAG recommendation for approval. Thank you.
Good evening, how y'all doing?
Good evening.
Hi, I just want to say second the motion. We really appreciate the opportunity.
State your name, please.
I'm sorry, I'm Zephon Wills. And I just want to say thank you for allowing us to come and talk to you about our petition. I want to just state real briefly that these are pretty much kids. We refer to them as young adults, but when you think about 12 to 16, you think about yourself between that age and some of the mistakes that you made and the decisions that you made. We owe it to ourselves, to as we made it to this position in life, to reach back and help those who didn't have someone to look out for them, didn't have someone to guide them. And so what this is simply an opportunity to give them that second chance. It's secure, it's safe, the children are well vetted, we're very organized, we've been doing this for a long time. We have staff that are skilled and experienced, they've been doing it for a long time. And like Liz just reiterated, we've been there for over 6 months and no one even knew it up until now. So that's just an example of how successful we are and how successful we can be. And everything that's on here, based upon your recommendations, there would be no big difference, no change, no serious impacts on the community, the schools, the systems, anything. Sprinkler systems have been updated. We already have the fire marshal's approval to increase it from 5 to 10 already. It's just a matter of you guys saying, it's okay. Thank you.
If you just take a seat, we'll give you a rebuttal to any opposition. Is there anyone here in opposition? Please come forward, Mr. Turner.
Right.
I'm Dale Turner. I own property next door to the facility mentioned in the Mount Zion neighborhood. The good doctor talks about our community, but this really I don't think is his community. He's a resident of DeKalb County. And at the zoning meeting, he said that he was able to come to the facility maybe once or twice a month to oversee the facility. If you read the Atlanta Journal-Constitution on Saturday, you saw where the headline said that because of troubled youth and gangs in DeKalb County, that the county was really in crisis. And I assume if the good doctor really cared about the young people in his community, he would buy the house next door to where he lives and set up a facility there. Now, there's no doubt that the youth of our community need guidance. They need help, especially those who have broken the law and got into trouble. And I'm certainly not opposed to helping them. But a quarter of a century ago, I sat where you're sitting now, and I know how difficult zoning decisions can be. And I think what you have to do is weigh profit of someone seeking a CUP, and they always do it for profit, against the preservation of a community. Now, that part of Mount Zion Boulevard still has people living there who care for their homes. They care for their children. For instance, the single lady next door to this facility teaches piano in her home, try to make a living. Elderly gentleman lives next door to this facility, lost his wife some time ago, in his 80s, just trying to hang on as long as he possibly can in this community. Across the street, there's a grandmother helping to raise her two grandchildren. She has no other place to go. She's been living there a long time, and she wants to finish out her life living there. So as you weigh profit against the community, the good of the community, I hope you'll come down on the side of the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else in opposition? Please come forward, ma'am.
Thank you. It's Patricia Hammett.
Hello, and good evening, and thank you for letting me speak. My name is Patricia Hammett. I do live across the street. I'm also that little grandmother, but I do have two grandchildren, 1-7, 1-13, next door. There's another family with a little girl, 9, and the little boy, around 13. And I can't say that I would feel safe with my little girls playing in the front yard. Now, I have noticed the boys up there playing basketball. I have seen no 12-year-olds, no 13-year-olds. These look like men up there. And they stated that the recreation that they could provide would be football, baseball, basketball. Well, where are they going to play these games? The backyard has been paved. The front yard has they have put in a large septic tank, but I understand you have to have a drainage fill, and that would have to be in the front yard, I suppose. Well, we also have plans to widen Mount Zion Boulevard. Now, is that going to take in that front yard? I have a deep well, and that bothers me.
And also, these boys are from a detention center. We don't know what crime they did to be in that detention center, so we have to think about that. Now, also, they said their usually average rate was 6 months. So every 6 months, we would have to be worrying all over again. Now, they said they have cameras up there that watch them. Cameras have never prevented a crime that I know of. And after maybe they decide they want to leave there and something happens, then it's too late to say anything then. And also, the value of the property would just drop. Would you want that next door to you? Would you want to try to sell your home with these juveniles living next door that have had not only a drug problem, but possibly other problems? So we would appreciate you considering this and help us to try to keep this neighborhood safe for people to raise their families in. So far, we've allowed other businesses there, and we have no objection to businesses, but this is just not a place that we would want to raise a family. And we feel like, I know this that they're doing is needed, but I just don't feel like it should be in our little neighborhood. We've got from Jonesboro High School all the way to Jonesboro Road, and it's one of the nice areas, and I moved there in 1956, raised four children there, so I love the community and want to keep it as clean and nice as it is now. And thank you for your time.
Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else? Please come forward. Hold on, ma'am. Let's take this lady here and then we'll get to you. Come on. Mm-hmm.
Just state your name for the record, please.
I'm Phyllis Oliver, and I live at 7257 Mount Zion Boulevard next door. And I realize they already have five. And I want to commend that they're doing a pretty good job with that. The only problem is 10 is going to be too many. To me, I won't feel safe because I have to live next door. And I have children entering in my facility, my house and everything. And I've seen them out there doing the basketball and everything. I haven't seen 12-year-olds, but I've seen, you know, maybe 16 or 17 or 18-year-olds they look like. But the main thing is, with concern, is that we want to, I don't oppose them having the five. I think 10 is going to be too much. I think 10 is pushing the limit, because that house, I've seen the inside of the house. I know what the house looks like, you know, and I knew the owner before that owner. And it does have quite a bit of rooms in it, but you cannot contain 10 boys there. There's just no way. And there's no way that you can monitor 10 boys 24/7 around the clock and nothing's going to happen. I just don't see it. I just don't see how that can happen. Because, you know, you may have three or four workers, but there's 10 of them. You see, and if one of them goes off, they could go off. You know, we don't know that. You know, but with their history of having trouble, it could happen. One could go off. And so I think with the community part of it is what I feel like, you know, because I have a business there too, but I also have a sense of community with the business, you see, and I'm not interrupting the community with my business. What happens is now, since I live by myself, you know, I would feel threatened. I don't feel like, you know, opening the door and having my fan on or this kind of thing. I wouldn't feel comfortable with that at all. You know, I'd have to stay within my home. It would confine me to my home. basically. Okay. You know what I mean? I couldn't, like, raise your window and put the fan up. And...
We understand.
Anyway, that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. This is Jean, is that Perry? She can't hear.
Good evening. My name is Jean Perry. I'm 81 years old. I grew up, graduated from Jonesboro High School, and have lived in the county all of my life until 7 years ago when my husband died, and I was forced to move. But I raised my children, lived 38 years at 7289 Mount Zion Boulevard. Those people are my friends. Our children grew up together, and I hate to see things go down for them. Roger Trammell, who lives right next door, could not come tonight because he is a severe diabetic. He got so upset at the last meeting and he didn't take his insulin right and became very, very ill. So I told him I would mention him tonight too. At the last zoning meeting, the fella talked about liberty and justice for all. He was talking about liberty for what he wanted. He wasn't considering the justice for the citizens who live there, who have paid their taxes all these years and have abided by the laws. I hope you will take that in consideration. Would you want a drug rehab place close to where you're raising your grandchildren? Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else in opposition? All right, Dr. Brady.
I'm not a fella. And they're not just boys, they're young men. I'm not a good doctor. I'm a black educated man. This is a nice area. I believe in showing the youth that if they can, you know, when we talk about change, we talk about rehab and rehabilitation, you have to be able to provoke change. You can't institutionalize our young men at such a young age because they will become institutionalized and will end up dead or in Clayton County Jail or in some federal prison. You have to give them something that they've not seen or tasted. Our program is fully licensed by the state of Georgia Department of Community Health, and we have all of the credentials and staff that the state of Georgia Department of Community Health places as standards. And I don't think anyone could utilize their perception not being trained clinically or have any form of experience from a standards perspective to determine if 10 kids could not be served in this area. On our left, there is a business. There is a business, and she operates a music school. We've reached out to her to even integrate some of our young men into the music. We want to integrate them in the community. It's been stated at our last meeting that we think that this is a good deed, but we don't want these types of boys in our community. Well, where do they go? Where do they go? Who do they turn to? We're not in a subdivision. We're on our own. And as the opposer said, they own their property. Well, I own my property. And I'm not a resident of DeKalb County. I would just ask that the standards that we meet that are set in place by the regulatory agencies we meet, we exceed. We have sprinkled, we're not even required sprinkled system, but we have sprinkled, we have a fully sprinkled system that we put in the house. We also have an upgraded septic system. The only thing we're asking for right now is an opportunity to reach our youth. It's not a matter of profit, because people are make this, the one gentleman said it, it's a matter of profit. It's not a matter of profit. There's no money in social services. It's a matter of reaching young men who are deemed to go and will literally die. She raised her kids in that community, and she wants to keep it a good community. But the young brother who died at 22 or 17, 18, shot in the head, shot in the back, my brother was shot. And he was special needs, 22 years old, shot in, he didn't have an opportunity, couldn't speak for himself, so we have to speak for him. We had another brother who was shot by the name of Josh, you know, and he was just, what, 17, 18? We gotta do something. We can't let people continue to control us. We have to take our youth. We gotta take them. That's all I'm saying. If we don't take them, who will?
Thank you, sir. All right, please take your seat.
Excuse me, Chairman.
Oh, yes. Wait a minute, are you for or in opposition?
Four.
Okay, come on, I'll entertain you.
Okay.
My name is Doris Long. I do not live in this community. I live in Atlanta. I own my home. I have a facility diagonally across the street from me that houses people that are being rehabilitated. I'm 74 years old. I have grandchildren, 12 grandchildren, 9 great-grandchildren. They play at my house. I have to have them at my house. As of right now, my granddaughter is in the hospital, and I have her 5 children in my house, and they range from a month and 2 days and 9 years old. I'm not afraid for these people to be rehabilitated across the street from me, because I believe that everybody should have a second chance. And if you don't have a second chance, what is there? I'm originally from New Jersey, and I have never seen such, I don't know, I'm not used to all of this way of living that people live here. I was in a community that was a handful of black, white, Indian, Polish people. They were displaced people that were in my neighborhood. My father was a tree farmer. We had wide open spaces. And now, I can't believe that people just don't want anybody else to live. It's not fair. I agree with him. And I agree with them having a place for young people to survive. They've got to be able to survive. And we have to help them. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you.
Are you speaking in favor or opposition, sir?
In favor.
Okay.
Thank you.
My name is Dr.
Hold on a second, sir. Okay. Ms. Haywood, how are we on time on the 10 minutes?
We're pretty much there.
Make it quick.
Oh, thank you, Chairman. My name is Dr. Omavi Bailey. I'm speaking in support of Dr. Brady. And I think what we also have to think about is change. It's inevitable. And it's possible to be comfortable with the status quo and to think that you can just have your home, lock your doors, and be safe, and that the world outside cannot affect what happens inside your home. And if you raise children, I have a daughter myself, we know that we are very concerned about what happens when our children leave the home. But the best way to ensure that our children are safe and that our community is well is to invest in all children, in all people. We are not living in vacuums. We are not able to isolate ourselves and have just one good community. But I think we have to share what we have. And I think that, in essence, this is an opportunity. It's not a threat, but it's an opportunity. And it's a challenge. But with change, the same change that these young men are going through, I think the entire community could benefit from. And that's all I'm going to say. Thank you.
Okay, Chairman Turner, just for the record, a letter was sent to us. It's a support letter from the Clayton County Community Development Department use permit from Andrew Young's Foundation in support, and it will be filed in the meeting folder.
Commissioner.
Sounds like a great program and a great service, and I wish all of it a lot of success. Obviously, there's a lot of passion here. Regarding the zoning matter, Ms. Kurzik, what is the age of the structure, do you know, when it was built?
Oh, the home itself?
The home.
I do not believe I have that with me.
Was it there 38 years ago when whoever it was moved next door? So it's not 40 years old, but is it 30 years old?
It was built there after I moved there.
Okay, so my concern is, and I know the doctor said 12 to 18, but the application says age of residence are 16 to 24 years old. And it also says that the structure is a 3,900 square foot single family residence that has 9 bedrooms, including one for staff. So we're talking about putting 10 patients into 8 bedrooms in a single family building residence built at least a couple of decades ago. And that causes me concern. The intent of the conditional use versus an existing structure causes me concern. The county's land use map, the future land use map, staff says this is not in conformance with the polity's intents or future land use plan of the comprehensive plan. So talking about the land and the actual building in question, I don't see how it could fit in that specific piece of property. Even though it seems like a wonderful program, and I wish it success, but with that being said, because the conditional use runs with the land and not the structure, and I don't see how the structure can possibly work for the applied application, I'm going to recommend denial.
That's your motion. Is there a second? Is there a second to the motion? Is there an alternative motion?
No. I was going to say, it was his district. Don't look up here. It's his district.
If there's a lack of motion, Ms. Barnes.
It's no action.
No action taken at this time.
No rezoning granted.
Okay.
All right.
Well, at this time, motion dies.
Okay, for lack of a section, second.
That's correct.
Okay.
I do actually have when the home was constructed.
Okay.
It was constructed in 1951 was the original permit.
Okay, thank you.
All right, I think we are finished here.
If there's no further business to discuss, we need a motion to go into executive session.
Is there a motion? I'll make the motion. Is there a second? We're going to executive session.
Second.
Probably moving to second. Those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.